Live. The hangout is on live air. Ciao, ciao, everybody, and welcome to Giallo Ciao Ciao, episode 40. Seven bloodstained orchids.
40. Wait. 40. Is that 40? Like my nail?
Do. Yeah. Everyone, hi, everyone, look at Chris's Giallo score thing he made. Very excited about that. It looks good, and it's the right way. I gave him some shit earlier, and it freaked him out a little bit, so I apologize.
I love getting some shit, though.
Yeah.
Especially from you.
And there's Eric and his nice microphone.
And Eric has a hat. What does your hat say? Oh, okay, the TCs.
That's right, the Twin Cities.
That's what that stands for.
That's what it stands for.
Does it?
Dork. I can't believe I never knew that.
The Twin Cities Twins. Professional baseball playing team of national baseball players.
But they're the American League, right?
That's true.
Yeah, don't try to fuck with me there, buddy.
I won't.
I know that. Kirby Puckett, yeah?
I'm a little upset that Chris didn't make us banners.
We should make our own banners. Mine's going to say penis score.
It's not too hard. I can show you how to do it real quickly. You just have to create an overlay and then make part of it transparent. That's all.
Well,
so ship it over and I'll hook it up for you.
Nice.
My limited knowledge of Photoshop paid off today when I made this thing. This is actually a little bit of trivia. If you go to my Twitter feed for Giallo Score, this is same graphic as turned sideways on the left-hand margin. So, there you go.
Wow.
Fun fact. Now, for all of the viewers out there watching us live, if you go to the Q&A bit, that is how you can talk to us. If you leave comments on the Google Plus page, I'm not going to read them. If you leave them on the YouTube page, I'm not going to read them. It's just because it's too damn confusing, and I have the attention span of a piece of plywood. So, yeah. So just do it on the Q&A part.
Right.
But tonight, our episode is so jam-packed with action, we could be confused as a porno shop in this episode. Not only are we going to be reviewing the classic film Seven Bloodstained Orchids, but we're also going to be going over our top 10 of the last 10, a time-honored tradition here on the Ciao Ciao, but we're also going to be picking our picks for the next three after the next one. Eric looks scared.
And our noses.
And our vagines. So, do you guys have your picks? We're not going to do it now.
Right.
We've got to build some suspense.
I've got a couple locked and loaded.
Yeah, I will have mine soon.
Probably the less time spent on the review, the better then, since we have all this other stuff to get to.
That means Eric was not thrilled with the orchids.
Hey, Creep.
Yes. Sanders has a question.
How did that bottle of JB in the background go down, or is it full?
How did that bottle of JB in the background go down? It went down not very smoothly. It was harsh. It took me probably about 30 episodes to drink it.
And didn't you normally mix it with, like, some sort of cappuccino latte thing?
No. I have my cappuccino latte here, because I have my Diet Coke here, and I have my hot cup of Java there, and I'm ready to go. I got my Ativan here. We're ready.
Get some Tums ready.
Yeah, but no, the first couple episodes I had a fifth of J&B. And that went down really quick. And if you go back and listen to those episodes, I was pretty drunk. So, yeah. So that's how that happened. But yeah, that's empty now. I fucked up and I don't have any J&B for the show tonight. So I apologize. Do you guys have any J&B for the show tonight?
You know, I don't.
I don't. I just have water.
Big. The worst Giallo people ever.
It's probably true, though. I think I should get some credit because I went to a brunch with my wife a couple Sundays ago, and I saw way up on the top shelf they had to get a pole out to get the J&B bottle. But I had a lot of J&B on a Sunday morning. Because it was the first bar I had actually seen a bottle of J&B at. That's some
place. Yeah, they usually don't promote that shit. They usually hide it down at the bottom.
Right. They don't. Yeah, they don't turn the label towards you usually when it comes to J&B. Even though it's such a beautiful label.
So, thank you for that question. Should we get into our top 10 of the first 10? The last 10.
We can go back to the first 10.
We could shit the last 10.
I know. I just want to kind of talk about Case of the Bloody Iris and Strip Nude for Your Killer again.
Eventually we'll have to when we run out of stuff. Yeah.
Sadly, as with the film we're going to talk about tonight, not every movie can be eyeball. So, so here we go. I did some clever math here, which is going to piss Chris off probably.
No, I know how it works now. Don't worry.
I had to change something because we had a three-way tie for number five. And that's the first time anything like that has ever happened.
We had a three-way?
That means, yeah, we had a three-way. Am I a mess. But this means either that our tastes are becoming similar somewhat, or we've just been rubbing off on each other too long.
No, it means that the two of you are finally getting smart and agreeing with me.
I like the rubbing off theory better.
Wait, what's number... Oh, I see what number five is. Dun, dun, dun! All right.
Bum, so I did some clever math.
Here's a hint. Bum, wait a minute.
Wait, what are you doing?
I'm not quite getting it. I need a couple more bars.
Wait a minute.
Oh, fuck. He's got the effects.
All right.
Usually you have to pay extra for those, Jason said. Is that for
going back to the ribbon tugs?
Yeah. I like how that's exactly what me and you were thinking. That's ridiculous. Okay, so I did some clever math, so I made it to where we're not tied.
Okay.
And I'll tell you how I judged that in a bit here. So are you ready for number 10?
Dun 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 dun.
Yes.
Number 10,
we're going to have Eric do his best Peter Lorre impersonation, because number 10 is none other than...
The Bat, starring Vincent Price.
The Bat. Yeah, Chris gave it a 10, I gave it an 8, and Eric gave it a 9. We did not like the movie, but for me, it just wasn't what I expect with the other films that we had in this list.
Yeah.
What do you guys think?
Well, I kind of wanted to preface this before we started that I thought this was actually a pretty strong 10, for me anyway. I know a lot of them had fan picks in there that we kind of trashed, but for the most part, overall, I did like them, other than when I was just ribbing the listeners. It was, The Bat, it just kind of fell into this place. It's this interesting diversion from a lot of the movies we've been watching, but altogether I just thought it was kind of an uninspired adaptation of the story that I've seen a couple other times, and Vincent Price was good in it, but it was just, yeah, not the best version of this story that's been told.
Yes, I agree with what Eric said. And may I add, I tend to rank these, you know, there's lots of different criteria. One of them is it a giallo and does it pertain to what we're doing here? But another one is, how likely am I to watch this movie again? And I don't think I will ever watch The Bat again. Mm-hmm. So that's why it ended up at number 10 for me.
Very nice. Very nice. Well, now at number 9, we have L'Orme. Or
L'Orme.
On the Moon. Now, this one... Are you supposed to be beating into me?
What you said? What? Do something to you? Oh, late.
No. Oh, I see what you did there. You're making fun of my amazing Italian accent.
No.
Chris gave this a 7. I gave it a 10. Yikes. And Eric gave it a 7.
All right, Eric. Good for you.
Yeah. It wasn't my favorite movie. It wasn't my least favorite movie, but it was much closer to my least favorite movie ever than it was to my favorite movie ever.
I see.
I'm not a fan of Mrs. Bulkin's head, and there was a lot of her head in this film. And that's basically kind of what did it for me. And there's a picture of her head.
Yeah, I'm doing this ghetto version of trying to do overlays of the films as we talk about them. As you can see, it's just a Google image tab. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you should close those porn sites, too. That makes you look a little...
Oh, crap! An amateur. Pegging. I'm back. Oh, wait. Okay,
I think with Footprints on the Moon, I liked it for it being kind of this dreamlike, unique film, but it was just rather sparse throughout as far as the plot, and Florinda Balkan was not looking her best in this one. She was a pleasant sight in Don't Torture a Duckling compared to this.
Not really. I mean, that one scene, yeah, when she's crawling up the hill after she got the hellbait out of her, she looked terrible. But anyway,
I'm just not a fan of her.
Yeah. All right, so here's the question. You have to have intercourse with Florinda Balkan. Do you pick a clean and non-bloody and non-messy short-haired version from L'Orme, or do you pick the completely almost about to die version from with longer hair from Don't Torture Duckling? And I open this up to everyone watching.
I pick
what a question.
Lizard skin.
Oh yeah, well I didn't throw that one in there. You gotta pick between those two.
Woman's skin. God, I guess bloody and vomiting. Oh, it's so gross, dude. Like
she really was that so unappealing in L'Orme, huh?
Yeah, it's like I wouldn't mind being a character in David Cronenberg's Crash, and just stick it in any one of those open orifices on her body.
Oh,
wow.
The truth comes out.
Ladies and gentlemen,
out.
If you have kids watching, I would advise putting them to bed now.
A little late
when
for that.
Eric hits the boiler room, the kids gotta go away. So what did you think about Footprints, Chris?
Well, yeah, I mean, again, going back to would I watch it again, I would watch it again. I thought it was a good film. Yes, sure, it would be great if they had taken a really extravagantly beautiful looking woman, like if they had put, you know, our favorites, Edwidge or Barbara Boucher into that script, it would have been a movie that everybody would have liked a lot more, I'm positive. But I think that Florinda did a good job from an acting standpoint, and, you know, the film is just, I like the script, I think it's beautifully filmed. It's very slow. So it's not the kind of thing that you want to put on when you're half asleep unless you want to watch it in order to make yourself fall asleep. But if you have the patience for it and enough caffeine and you focus on the visuals and I guess the way that the story is kind of a slow burn, it's worth a second viewing. Because I watched it twice before we covered it for the podcast because I wanted to make sure I got enough out of it. But again, it's number seven for me because the other ones that we did this go-around were much better, other than a couple. And yeah. I would like to mention again that except for Don't Torture a Duckling and Seven Blood-Stained Orchids, all the rest of these are fan picks, right? Our Facebook pick people. So Sweet was, yep, so Sweet was so. Al's, yeah. Right? And I think the rest of them were just all from the voting.
Yep.
So we have I thought the top five were really hard for me to pick. The bottom five were kind of easy because they, you know, they went along with, you know, how likely I am to watch them again. But the top five were hard. My number one and my number two. Yeah, my number one and number two I went back and forth with about three or four times. But anyway, I'm not jumping ahead, but I'm jumping ahead.
Well, Jason has a question here. Chris, do you really want us to ask that question? Some of us may have answers that the FBI would be interested in.
Yeah, I'm sorry. It's a would you rather kind of question that's probably best reserved for not broadcasting to the entire world.
Yeah.
No FBI listening to this,
I would say.
Right.
Well, let's hurry up and get through the show before we get shut down. So number eight, this was a kind of a shock for me. I thought this would be up higher, but Opera.
No, yeah. That sounds about right. I had it up higher than eight, but I know that you guys didn't really like it that much, so that's why it came down a little bit.
Yeah.
You had it at number six. I had it at seven. And Eric had it at eight. And I'm shocked that I had it above Eric.
It was, I don't know, I guess talking about flip-flopping, I flip-flopped between this and Footprints on the Moon, but I put them in this order just because I think, for me, Opera overall just had unlikable characters. Not saying Florin de Balkan was anything. Obviously, I'd rather do the injured one over the one in Footprints, but I just like that one a little bit more because of the atmosphere and the unique quality to it. Oh, is that a scene from the movie? I can't remember.
Yeah, that's there's the eyeballs with the tape and the needles.
Okay. I think she could still shut her eyes. I call bullshit.
Right. It's just...
Let's not go back there again.
It's just kind of a labored film. It does have good kills in it. I'll give it that, obviously.
Yeah, I mean...
For me, the ending was just so ludicrous and ridiculous. Like... Yeah.
It's certainly not anywhere near Argento's best film, so... certainly... you know, would you put Opera at the bottom of all the Argento films? It depends on where you're cutting it off, right? So,
yeah,
Opera came after Phenomena, I think. And then after after Opera, we had Two Evil Eyes and then Trauma.
Yeah.
So, and Trauma, I think, is better than Opera.
I think so, too.
Although, it's not much better. It's a little better. So, yeah, but, you know, anything after that, I mean, Opera, I guess, depends on if you're comparing it to The Card Player. Ugh. I'd take Opera any day, but... Anywho.
All right, so the next one on our list, this was one of the ones that was tied for five. So at number seven, we have Death Walks at Midnight. a film that Chris picked at 8, I picked at number 2, and Eric picked at number 6. So who wants to take this first?
Well, you should take it, because you think it's worthy of number 2, so let's hear
it. It was a lot of effing fun. Like, I think the stupidest part of the whole movie was the weapon. But other than that, it was a lot of fun. I have grown accustomed to enjoying butthole face movies. And
what's Eric doing?
I don't know. It's kind
of... He's stringing up some sort of an animal on the side of the
screen there.
Doing my own Fulci film here. Right. Or just charging my damn computer.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I tried to watch that film a few times, and I don't know, man. It's not as fun as Death Walks in High Heels.
Not at all. Yeah.
But you know, to put it above most of what we've done here for, you know, I don't know what your number one is, but I'm assuming that it's not. Well, I shouldn't assume anything, but.
You should not assume a damn thing, sir.
I would assume that, you know,
crazy here.
With as many films as I put above Death Walks, I would think that there's at least one more that's better than that for you. But, you know, listen, this is America. This is why we do this.
If I want to put a hot dog and potato chips on my fucking cheeseburger, I can fucking do that.
You can.
You could put hot dog in your pizza crust.
All right, so real quick before we go on, we do have another comment here. The ending of Opera was from the book Red Dragon. Argento was mad they didn't use it for that. They didn't film that for Manhunter, so he used it himself in Opera.
Oh, yeah, I read about that.
Is that a legit thing?
Yeah, I read about that somewhere. So there was a... The guy who did the Miami Vice show, was it Michael Mann or something? He did the original Manhunter that had the guy from...
Monster Squad.
Yeah. And that was like a low-budget made-for-TV film. And then they redid it with Anthony Hopkins and... what's his name? Ed Norton. But I guess in the book, the ending of the book was... I didn't read the book, but I guess the ending has to do with the fact that... I know, because in at the end of Manhunter, there's a fire, right? And the killer is consumed in the flames. But
I haven't read the book. Jason says that actually makes sense, having read the book. So apparently that is very legit, and now I'm going to go read that book.
Yeah, I've not read the book, just seen the Anthony Hopkins version and have not seen the Michael Mann version, so not too helpful.
And I think both of them are good versions. I like them both. I think Ed Norton was good in it, and Ralph Fiennes was good in the modern version, but there's some pretty like spooky, chilling scenes in that original one that are just like they're subdued, but they're really like, you know, they're really frightening. But at any rate.
So, Death Walks at Midnight. Eric, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree that it's the lesser of the Death Walks duology. I think that's what you call it. And I still thought it had an interesting enough premise to be memorable, like the other film that he did. Just not quite as much, and I like the kill weapon. I don't know why. I just thought it was goofy. It looked really strange on his hand, but it was something I enjoyed. It was something memorable, and that's kind of what that's all I really need when you get all these films that seem to run together in terms of similar signatures and things like that.
All right.
Yeah, and the soundtrack for Death Walks is really good. I like it a lot. Mm-hmm. So. I can always give it more points just for the soundtrack, for sure.
So number 6 is 7 Bloodstained Orchids. Now this we're not going to talk too much about right now, But Chris picked this at number one. I picked it at number six. And Eric picked it at number 10. So I am now the voice of reason in this conversation.
You're the
for once.
Resolution expert.
If you say so.
So we'll talk more about that in a minute. So let's jump right into number five, which is New York Ripper. Chris picked it at five, I picked it at five, and Eric picked it at five.
Well, there you go.
So, middle of the fucking road movie.
Yeah.
Yep.
I think it's people could agree with that.
Yeah.
Excellent.
It's kind of dirty, kind of gory.
Mm-hmm. It's entertaining throughout, I think, from beginning to end. It's just, yeah, way more gore than story, anything like that. And it kind of, it's a late cycle Fulci movie, so you can't really expect too much storytelling in it.
Let's see here. And then number four is Red Queen Kills Seven Times.
Piece of shit.
Chris had this at number nine. Wow. I had it at number four, and Eric had it at number two. Now, this movie, I had a really hard time with this Seven Bloodstained Orchids and New York Ripper. I kept changing it in my list over and over and over and over again. And I think why this one got picked four for me was just because I liked it better than New York Ripper and Seven Bloodstained Orchids.
Okay. That's
it.
Well, that's pretty logical of you.
Yeah.
Yeah, I try.
Throw logic into it.
What do you think about it, Chris?
I think it's a piece of shit. I hate that movie. That's all. No. I can't watch The Red Queen anymore, and that's why it's number nine. It's better than number 10 because it's a giallo. It's got Barbara Boucher in it. It's got a couple of other hot girls in it. It's got a really awesome soundtrack. So, and I've watched it maybe three or four times, but I'm done with it. I'm not going to watch it anymore. I think that the main guy, the protagonist, the guy who runs the show, or the amateur detective, is a complete like douche. Like I hate looking at him. He makes me get all like, ugh. And Barbara Boucher's hair, it looks terrible. The shoulder length palm thing makes you look like a dog. And the ending is so stupid with her being trapped in the thing and all that, all the cops coming in and everybody trying to release the water from the wherever the room was, and it's just stupid.
You seem a little more violent about it than you did when we reviewed it.
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, well, you know, I try to be respectful of people's wishes and people's opinions. But the more I think about it, and, you know, I had to think about it again for this top 10. You know, I had to go through each of the films and say, okay, where would I put this one? And Red Queen was a film that I was really excited to watch originally when I had bought the Emilio Mari, whatever the heck his name was, double box set with the little figurine of the Red Queen. And I watched the other one first, Evelyn Came Out of the Grave, and I got stuck. I got stuck in between. And the night Evelyn Came Out of the Grave, I still haven't watched all the way through. It's not a traditional giallo. And so I switched over to the other one. I'm like, oh, this is much better. It's, you know, it's a knife-wielding killer and everything. But the more I watch it, the more I think about it, it's just a rip-off movie. They're all rip-off movies if you look at them. But this one has got, like, the worst protagonist. And they even, like, they use the exact same apartment that they used for Strange Vice of Mrs. Ward. And Cry of the Prostitute, says Dr. Night Gaunt, is the Boucher I should watch. So, yeah, my favorite Boucher moment is when she gets the lesbian thing going on with whoever that is in Amok, which is a good film. But at any rate, yes, I don't think I'll watch it anymore. If I had to watch, yeah, like I put that below Leorme. Yeah, I would watch Leorme. If you gave me both of them and said watch one, I'd pick Leorme. Sorry.
Wow, you're just a big old douchebag, sir. Look at that.
What was that?
Cry of a prostitute. I can't wait to sink my things into that. Well, maybe I should pick The Night Evelyn Came Out of the Grave later, just to make you have to watch Red Queen again, because you'll want to.
Wow. I would like end up liking that one more, because it just went backwards on me for some reason. I don't know. Weird.
Anyway. Eric, what do you think?
You put this
one pretty high.
Put it pretty high, relatively, compared to the other movies that we have on those. That could very well have been a number two, but I gave it that because I do really like the throwback plotting to it. It seems like an old movie, old dusty horror movie I would like. But it's kind of modernized. It's a little slick, a little cleaned up for modern times, and it's got some beautiful women in it, like Chris mentioned. And I think it's got probably the most memorable-looking killer from one of these movies I've seen in a long time, which is kind of refreshing to see as well, even though it did turn out to be kind of goofy at the end. I just really liked... I got kind of spooked watching that white, ghastly face with the long black hair and the red overcoat running around at night. It's just kind of spooky.
It was. I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
So, number three, we have Don't Torture a Duckling. Right. Chris gave this a number two, Eric put it at number one, and I put it at number nine.
You son of a bitch.
So go ahead.
I'm actually happier about you putting Duckling at nine than I am about you putting Orchids at... Where'd you put Orchids? Six?
Six, yeah.
Maybe not. Yeah. Okay, that's cool. I think we're in agreement, except we're relatively in agreement. So
relatively.
Yeah. Anyway.
Eric,
tell us why it's nine.
This is your number one. Oh, you want me to tell you why it's nine?
Because
you go first.
Like, the killing of the kids, it wasn't bad, but it's not something that I'm like, ooh, I can't wait to go watch a movie where someone kills a bunch of little boys. The reveal, not the reveal, but like, how do I say this without, by this time watching this, I was completely over the whole priest being bad. It had just, for me, been done in so many other films that I had seen that it wasn't a shock, and look at that devil. But the reason why...
Wait, the priest being bad. There we go.
Yeah.
Where's my halo?
You're a clown.
There it is.
Okay, well, there it is. So, but the reason why it's higher than Leorme is because Barbara Boucher is super hot. And she had on some fancy clothes and had a cool little apartment. But when you think about it, that has absolutely dick to do with the story. So.
Yeah, I could see this being knocked down for some people towards the bottom half, but nine, man, that's a little too low.
Yeah, no, I don't agree. I like the film a lot. I don't know how much Creep's score is influenced by the fact that the subject matter is off-putting, and that's totally respectful. I get it. Boucher is 10 times better looking in this one than in Red Queen. So if we're just voting based on Boucher, then, you know, Duckling goes above Red Queen. But I have a tendency to think that Eric may have put it at number one because he's seen it a couple times already and maybe more familiar with it than all the other ones. But
yeah, it does help. But I just am a sucker for these types of movies and the settings and the music, and I thought it was, you know, for a story, it was for Fulci, it was coherently constructed and pretty simple to follow and engaging throughout. And child killing doesn't affect me, so I don't know what that says about me. But.
What would, if you guys had to pick the best Fulci movie, or maybe just your favorite Fulci movie, what would it be? Like all of them, not just question? No, not just the Giallo. I'm talking about all Fulci, all the way across the board, horror movies and everything.
I'm not really a fan.
Yeah, we know you're not a fan, but I might say this one. I like zombie. I like sitting down and watching zombie just for the heck of it with friends.
Yeah. Maybe
a couple brewskis on the loose-ski. But if I'm going to take in a piece of Fulci cinema, it'd probably be this one.
What do you say, Chris?
I don't know. I mean, I like The Beyond a lot. Mm. I like all those kind of early 80s sort of zombie, sort of not zombie films.
Yeah.
Dr. Night Gaunt said The Beyond as well. Zombie, House by the Cemetery.
That kid just drives me fucking crazy in it, dude.
And he's in Blade of the Rip or Blade in the Dark too, right? In the beginning.
Uh-huh. I would have to say for me zombie, but it's not so much the movie, like the soundtrack for Zombie.
Yes.
Is like one of my favorites.
Yeah, it's
even
great.
Though it sounds exactly like House by the Cemetery, if I recall. Or City.
Gates of Hell.
I don't know. There's one other movie that the score is almost exactly the same.
Yeah, but I think you're right.
But Zombie is fun-ish.
I think The Beyond, too. I mean, out of all the Jolly, I think, we talked about this last time, I think Don't Torture is probably his best one. But like Eric said, it's probably his most, not only well-written and coherent script, but I think it was probably his most, I think the attention to detail and the quality of his direction was at its highest point for that film. I think he didn't do any, like, he didn't just, there was no bullshit in Don't Torture a Duckling. I think some of his other later films, it looked like he was kind of like phoning it in at certain points. I think he really paid attention to this one. So, but
if I mean,
the guy directed so many films. I mean,
if there are any other viewers out there that want to chime in on that, what's your favorite?
Who doesn't want the priest falling off the cliff?
The priest falling off the cliff looks like shit.
I love it.
I have that book, Dr. Night Gone. It's really awesome. It's huge.
Which book is it?
It's called Beyond Terror, I think. It's a soft cover, but it's really, I mean, I think it was like 50 or 60 bucks. And
so it's coming back in September, is that what he said?
Into print, yeah. It's been out of print for a while.
All right.
Anyway.
So let's jump into number two here.
Number two.
Number two. All right. Yeah. Jerks. Number two, we have Forbidden Photos.
All right.
Finally. A woman who got stuff happened to her. Chris picked this at number four. I put it at number three. And Eric put it at number four.
Huh.
It's just a pretty movie.
I have to say, I'm kind of surprised. I thought that you guys didn't like that as much. As
what?
Just in general, I thought that was going to show
I like
up further down.
Better.
Did you really? Well, yeah, you put that at two, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But yeah, this was good. Let's see. Jason says, honestly, I'm a hardcore New York Ripper fan just because as a Tom and Jerry fan, I love the idea of Little Quack as a homicidal maniac. Awesome. The priest falling off the cliff along with any long falls in Giallo look like crap, and they are incredibly entertaining.
Hell yes.
Sanders Keel.
Thank you, Sanders Keel.
There were sparks coming off of his face, for fuck's sake. That's all I'm going to say.
When else are you going to see that?
All right, in Terminator. or something. But anyway.
So yeah, Forbidden Photos, I think you guys, you know, I put it at 4. I think it's my favorite of a Luciano Ercoli's films, all 3 of them. I picked that one to be my favorite, with Death Walks in High Heels 2nd and Death Walks at Midnight 3rd. I like that one a lot, but I liked some of the other ones that we did a little bit better. I think Duckling is such a classic film that it's got to be higher, and some of the other ones that we've done this round are a little bit better than that, but it's a good one. It's definitely one that I return to watch or even just to listen to the soundtrack because it's really great.
Eric, what do you think?
I think it's got some actual clever twists, which for as many twists as there are in Giallo, a lot of them aren't too clever, and I like the ones in this one. It was a very, very sexy movie.
Very.
You know what I mean? Just had a, you know, in all senses of the word, it was had a sexy cast, and it just felt sexy, the sets and the wardrobes. And I had a great cast overall, and I loved the music like we were talking about, and it's just a well-shot movie, I think, which is another thing I have to give it credit for.
I agree. Jason says, oh, I keep forgetting to write you guys about Forbidden Photos. The cane weapon in there wasn't an Italy-specific device. Sword sticks like that have been popular since the Victorian age.
Jack the Ripper used it.
Wow.
Actually, I don't
that
know.
Was badass.
But yeah,
so let's go with our number one.
We all know what it is.
Then say it.
We all know what it is.
I say it's So Sweet, So Dead.
It is So Sweet, So Dead. Yay. I put it at number one. Chris put it at number 3. And Eric put it at number 3. You guys need to quit sharing each other's brain. It's driving me effing crazy.
Well, yeah, I mean,
but I put this at number 1 because it, out of the movie of the kind that I like that we watched this time, it was one I hadn't seen before, and it was a lot of fun. It had everything I wanted in it and more.
Mm-hmm.
It was super.
It was sleazy, but a good kind of sleazy. Not Ursula kind of sleazy.
Yes.
Still, it's just a peak Giallo film at a peak time for the subgenre.
Cool. Yeah, beautiful film. I loved it. I picked 2 that I thought were better, but it was a film that I had never seen before. Let me see. Out of all of these films, I had never seen Le Orme, and I had never seen The Bat, and I had never seen So Sweet, So Dead. And we need more of those. We need more of those So Sweet, So Dead films to watch for this show, because I think that we all like those films. We like them where there's enough of a mystery, where it's interesting, and there's a cool couple of plot twists, but for the most part, we like set pieces, we like the murder sequences, we like the tits and ass, and we like really cool music. So
yeah, I just like kinda, it when a movie is fun, and that is a fun movie.
Yeah, I agree. Like So Sweet, So Dead. So let's another impromptu poll, everybody. Are you ready? So Sweet, So Dead. Put them in order. Case of the Bloody Iris and Strip Nude. What are your preference? That's or an eyeball. An eyeball.
Shit. It would be Eyeball, Case of the Bloody Iris, and then a tie with So Sweet, So Dead, and Strip Nude. Yeah.
Yeah, I would go,
just like always.
You could flip them back and forth, yeah. I would go with So Sweet, So Dead. And then maybe, I think I would do Strip Nude, just slightly edging out Eyeball, and I still have to put Case of the Bloody Iris down below. I mean, I know we said that we all like these kind of movies, but that one still just hasn't rubbed me the right way. I don't know.
Okay, and now here's the right answer. Everybody ready? Case of the Bloody Iris comes first.
Good Lord.
Then So Sweet, So Dead. Then Eyeball, then Strip Nude. That's the end.
Okay. I don't know.
You're a jerk. Getting back to the cane, Jason says, they deployed more easily than a sword cane, not as loud as a pistol, and they were more elegant than a simple weighted head on a cane.
About those canes, I'm kind of worried.
Babette says, love so sweet, so dead. I like the visual storytelling. It really reeked out with stuff like so sweet, so dead. Peaked out. And then, let's see here. Jason said, eyeball strip nude, so sweet, and iris.
Where it belongs.
Sorry. And well, you know, let me say this. I'm going to, just because I have the utmost respect for Mr. Creeperson, and because I really don't want to watch The Strange Color of Your Body's Tears yet, I think... I think I might watch Eyeball again just for fun, and maybe I'll have a couple of beverages before I watch it, and we'll see what happens.
Eyeball is so much fun. Okay, so that was the top 10 of the last 10. So,
cool. That was fun.
That was a lot of fun.
I think so.
What's that?
That's the show for tonight.
That's the show for tonight. So now... we are going to talk about the movie that was ranked number 6 in our list, Seven Bloodstained Orchids. That could get confusing, but I just wrote Orchids, just so that wouldn't be an issue. We already, for those of you who sent in the listener picks, I already got a couple of them, but we're not doing those until next week. So if you want to put your top 10 of the last 10 together, go ahead and send them, and we'll talk about it on the next show. So, okay. Seven Bloodstained Orchids was my pick. It is an Umberto Lenzi film, who is one of my favorites of the genre. And this film had been asked a bunch of times for us to do. And because this one is not one of my favorites of his, I have been putting it off. So now we're going to talk about it. So let me give you a little menagerie of a plot here. A bunch of bitches get killed and put the, get this little crescent moon thing put in their hand. And then one girl almost gets killed in the train. They said she's killed, and she's not. And then the movie gets really fucking boring, and then later, you find out who did it. Thank you. That is the synopsis of this. Do any of you guys have anything a little more literary that you would like to share as a synopsis for this film?
Absolutely not.
Beautiful.
Did you just have a book out?
No. Yeah, he's looking at porn. Leave him alone.
This book.
I have it handy. You want to read from that one, Eric? That's cool.
Oh, sure. We're doing the more literary version of it.
Yeah. For the layperson, you know.
A killer begins murdering young women, leaving a half-moon pendant as a kind of calling card at the scene of the crime. When Julia is attacked and nearly killed, the police and her husband, Mario, decide to let the killer believe that she has died from her wounds, so that they can try and get the upper hand. I will say that I did like that part of the plot. That was kind of
fun.
The series of killings continue, and eventually it transpires that all the victims have a connection, which helps Mario to unmask the culprit. And then we come down to the
culprit. Sorry.
And a bunch of bitches die.
Torsten says that my synopsis was great and spot on.
I think they were talking about mine, actually.
No, I am going to take credit for that one. Thank you so much. So yeah, this movie is a whole lot of fun the first 20 minutes. The first 20 minutes of this movie are so much fun. My favorite bit in it, well, not my favorite bit, but it just, it's perfect, like, Lenzi everything. Within the first 2 minutes, some chick gets killed, and then another chick is about to get killed, but right before she gets killed, she says, let's get at it, because she's a hooker, and she's, like, naked, and she's ready to go. Mm-hmm. And that's just like usually Lindsay's storytelling. Let's get at it. Like,
yeah, but
let's cut all this other fucking boring shit out and let's just fucking get at it. And that was great.
But I mean, let's talk about that for a second, because I don't think the very first person was actually murdered. I think that the killer goes into that house and he puts his hand over her face or something, and it turns out to be this old woman, and then he looks over and there's a picture of the girl he's looking for. Right? They never show you what happens. And plus, don't forget that the killer only killed the 7 girls that were related, with the exception of Barrett at the end. So,
You don't know if that old lady was at the hotel with her skanky daughter. And B, why didn't that old lady call the cops and say, hey, some fucking psycho just tried to fucking kill me in my bed? Because that cop was pulling shit out of thin air left and right. And he should have been able to add that onto the list of things.
True.
But I'll give you the benefit of the doubt.
But it's ambiguous. Let's put it that way.
She was probably out of those little tokens that you had to use to call people.
That's it. A jetoni.
Yes.
You like that? You like that? Creep, this happens to you a lot, right? And maybe it's the films. Maybe it's you, maybe it's both. It seems to me like when they make these films, they start them out strong. They know that the middle section is going to be boring, and that's okay because most of the people aren't paying attention to the films anyway. And then they throw in some cool stuff at the end. And so every time we watch a film, like, I know that most of the time, Creep, you're like, yeah, it started out great. It was so interesting. The first 15 minutes, the first 20 minutes. And I think that's probably... I don't know. I think they did that on purpose. So I watched these films, and I kind of know that the middle section is going to be slow. I didn't think that this film was as slow as some of the other Giallo that we've watched as far as like an investigation. I thought it kind of moved pretty fast. But
sorry. Okay, first off, I take great offense to your statement, Sir Chris.
Okay. Awesome.
Just so you know. But real quick, we have a couple comments. If you like Lindsay, then it'll be hard to beat Rome armed to the teeth. That sounds epic, and I'm going to try to look for that tonight. And then Jason says, come on, Creep, do you really think the Italian cops would care about a woman that far outside of his preferred range of hotness? That makes perfect sense, and I agree. That's probably why they didn't give a shit. The chick wasn't hot, so they just, like, ignored her phone call. Yeah.
They probably get calls like that every single night.
That's right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Now, I'm not going to say that you're wrong.
I'm wrong.
Because everything has to start off with a bang, okay, to get people interested in something. But I got one compound word for you, sir. Eyeball. That movie is relentless. It never lets up. That movie never gets boring. There's a lot of movies that don't get boring. I feel like there's times when they're just kind of filling reels to make a runtime that they're supposed to have for their distributor or something. But
and I think they did this obviously a couple of times in Orchids. So, and I have some notes on that.
Yeah. But I'm going to take the middle ground here, as usual. I do think it started off with a bang, and I do think that movies that do generally do leave you feeling disappointed when it does kind of slow down. But there are some that I can understand, like Black Belly kind of does it a little bit.
No, it does not.
Black Belly
is an action-packed romp through Italy.
Possibly. I'm just saying that's... I was actually defending that one. I'm saying that's one that kind of did it right, where it was one that you could follow and after the beginning, and it was just a lot of fun. And this one, it just was to a nauseating degree how trite and... I don't know. I can't think of the right words to describe it right now. It just got so labored and boring with... And especially Antonio Sabato, Sr., not Junior. Let's not confuse
him. Fucking hell, dude.
No, not Junior.
He was just unwatchable.
Awful.
As the
awful.
He didn't want to be there, so it's like, why should I have to be here watching you? So I don't blame Lindsay for it. I say that he had the cards stacked against him. I feel a little bad for him because I do like his stuff generally. I think, like you're saying, this one, it doesn't have a pretty beginning. And I kind of like that. I like the grimy grittiness of the dark, moody, gruesome kill scenes of the prostitute. And
the best street for hookers I've ever seen in my life.
Oh, yeah, but it looked just like Tenebrae, right? Didn't it look like the same?
That street was way better, though.
Really?
Like, there was, like, way more hookers than cars. It was like a riot. It was like a hooker riot.
I'm doing my Mario impression.
Al, you need to find out where those hookers were, because we're all gonna go on a trip.
See, I didn't have that much of a problem with Mario. I thought he was okay. I mean, you know, it wasn't as bad as that fucking guy from Death Walks, or from Red Queen. Come on, you gotta like him better than that.
Ridiculous, sir.
You gotta like him better than that.
He looks like a family circus cartoon, and he says, "Have you seen this man?"
Listen, that's the funniest part, and I have some serious. I have notes that we have to discuss that because it's so funny. But
do you guys? Did you guys ever watch The Tick?
Yes.
The old cartoon. Do you remember Little Wooden Boy?
Yep.
Little Wooden Boy could have played that part better than Mr. Sabato. That's exactly what it was.
Very obscure.
Okay, I'm sorry, Chris. Go ahead.
No, it's okay. It's cool. So, did you guys notice, and we haven't covered this other film on the cast yet, but this film starts out exactly the same way as Strange Vice does. There's a guy in black gloves driving a car down a busy urban street at night, and then... You know, in Strange Vice, it turns out that he's near the airport. Clearly, it was done way better in Strange Vice. But it's the same thing. And I looked it up. So Strange Vice was out in January of 71. This came out in February of 72. So, I mean, the beginning scene of this film is so similar to Strange Vice of Mrs. Ward that it couldn't be a coincidence, I don't think.
Is it? The like at least when the credits start, isn't Strip Name for Your Killer the exact same too? Like the credits are driving through the city street at night.
Well, Case of the Bloody Iris is the credit sequence starts with the driving, but it's during the daytime, yeah. And the guy's driving and chasing the one girl who goes to the phone to make the call. I forget how Strip Nude starts. I haven't seen it in a while.
It starts with some fur burger and a gyno exam.
Yeah, that's true.
I knew that would jog your memory.
That part.
Okay, talk about the part you wanted to talk about.
We have Riz Ortolani, who did the soundtrack. And did you guys hear, like, I don't know why it is, but I guess because Cannibal Holocaust is such a film that just stays with you, especially the music. It sounded like there was parts of that music. Obviously, this came first. But I think Ortolani did a lot of recycling of his soundtrack items. With this particular soundtrack, and I didn't find it that the entire soundtrack had been published anywhere or released anywhere, but that one theme gets overused in the film. Like, every time Mario gets in the car to go somewhere else, or whenever the scene changes to the next scene, they start it with that theme, or sometimes they start it with the faster paced version. And I really liked the theme, but it got so overused in this particular film that by the end I was like, okay, we need another track, please.
The theme is one of the things that I actually really like about the movie, because it's like the low end of it is very like jazzy and kind of hip and dancey, but then the highs on it are really eerie and kind of frightening. Yep. You know, and it's such a good blend. I love it. But yeah, it's like Bloody Iris. It's like the same song played every 2 seconds.
Dun, dun, dun. Oh no, that's an eyeball. Yep. So my first point for discussion, and we're not going through this linearly, I guess, The priest did it. Anyway, my first point of discussion is... the first
does it, though, so it's...
The second murder is Kathy Adams. And she's the girl who has the painting in her house. Why did the cats need to be poisoned? Does anybody understand that, or was it just for the effect of the film? Like, I go through this...
Go ahead.
Question with the sub-A question. The reason why I like this film is because I went through it kind of scene by scene, and I guess I took the cue of, okay, this is moving a little slowly, to really kind of dissect the story. And there's a million holes in this story, but it just, I like the way that it goes together. I like the way that they go from following one clue after the next, and I like how all of the characters come together. They're all connected in some way, but how are they connected? You know, as I went through, I just kind of went and put some discussion points together, and I didn't understand why the cats needed to be poisoned. Just, anybody know?
I think it's kind of like a cat of nine tails thing. He poisoned her milk, and she gave it to the cats.
Really?
That's where I was going, headed with it, too. Although this milk didn't have to be, this milk maybe was for the cats because it was refrigerated, whereas her milk doesn't have to be refrigerated, so maybe the killer just mixed that up.
Hmm.
No, I'm going with the...
Jason thinks that the killer was a dog... Jason thinks the killer was a dog lover, so we'll give him that.
Yeah. See,
those cat deaths hit me a lot harder than any child killing.
Well, because you have cats. I'm allergic to cats, so I didn't give a fuck.
Right. I'm allergic to cats, too, and I have children. So I'm not allergic to my children. Okay, I got another question. So I like what they did with making it look like Julia was dead and having the whole funeral thing. And then in the hospital, when they finally bring her out and she gets in the car and they're about to drive away and she notices that the half moon key ring, which was actually mailed to her by the killer because the killer didn't have enough time to leave it at the scene. And Mario puts it on his keychain. So do you think they were trying to turn him into a suspect for just a little bit of time, or do you think do you think it was more to make to segue into that flashback? Because she was like, oh, okay, now I remember seeing it. It was on a keychain, you know. And having it on the keychain was what triggered her memory.
He's like, oh yeah, it looks different on a keychain. No, it doesn't. It's a fucking goddamn fucking half moon crescent thing. It looks exactly the same as it does other times.
Fucking but, goddamn fucking.
Yeah. I just, like, he was fucking awful, and she was lucky she had a pretty face, because, like, she was just as fucking annoying. In my book.
You didn't like her.
They were awful.
I thought they needed more of her.
I thought she was pretty. I mean, she was kind of, like, conservatively pretty. She wasn't, like, super, like, sexy pretty, but she was pretty. So, how about this one? Remember when they go to the hotel, they ask about the ledger, and the guy says, we don't have any information about the ledger. And then, so first of all, it was so confusing because they said, okay, there was an American, and he was the guy who had the half moon. So, and now I remember him. He used to come in and eat at the hotel, but then he didn't stay there. He had his own place. So let's go to that place. So unless you're paying close attention, they drive out to find that place where he used to live, but it's closed for the season. It's some sort of seasonal rental. So then they go to the hotel where she used to work, and the guy's like, oh, we changed. The whole staff changed. There's nobody here. So they leave, and then they're driving halfway back, and Julia says, but wait, why don't we just check the records to see who was there? And then they, like... And then Mario does this crazy U-turn where he almost flips the car over and they head back to the hotel again. And I'm trying to figure out, you know, like, I always think about these things, like, did they script that part and say, okay, we're going to go to the hotel, and then we're going to leave the hotel, and then we're going to go back to the hotel, or did they decide, you know, let's at the last minute, we need to extend the run time, and we want to show Antonio driving around in a hot rod for a few seconds.
Honestly, they had a cool shot of him on a roundabout, and they're like, how are we going to fit this in here? Let's just make him like leave and then come back.
Right.
Because that was, if you look at that street, there was nowhere else for him to go. It was like a fucking cul-de-sac. Like, where the fuck else is he going to go?
Yeah, it was dumb. That one was like a head-scratcher. So, okay, so they come up with this list of all the women who have something in common. They were all at the hotel at a particular time, and Julia says that even though the page has been torn out of the ledger, that all the people on the day before and the day after should represent all the people that were there on the day when the page gets ripped out, right? But why is that? Why wouldn't anyone have left before that day? Is it because it landed on a weekend or something? Like, what was the logic behind that?
I think the logic there is that if someone checks in on Monday and they're there on Wednesday, they were probably there on Tuesday.
Yeah, you wouldn't check out and then check back in on another day.
The thing that's weird is that, like, what if someone left on Tuesday? That's what you're saying, right?
And that's what Mario says. He says, well, what if somebody left on the 29th? And she says,
they could never do that.
That would, yeah, well, no, they wouldn't have, because no one would have left on the 29th. And he says, oh, and that's it. That's the explanation. And I didn't know if there was some kind of weird thing, like cultural thing, like you go in a particular part of Italy at a particular season in the year, and maybe the 29th was a particular day of the week when people just, you know, like, nowadays, you can go and check into a hotel any day of the week in modern society, but maybe back then, they didn't have office hours on the 29th because it was a Sunday. And so you had to check in on Saturday, and you wouldn't leave again until Monday because you're there for the weekend or something. I don't know.
But then wouldn't the killer know that too and take all the pages?
Take all three pages, right, of course. Well,
or take the book.
But you can argue that the killer was in a rush and he found the first page and he grabbed it and he remembered He remembered what day it was.
Yeah. He was just looking for names. He wasn't trying to hide anything.
They wouldn't have accepted a one-night booking during the peak season, says Torsten Luth. It's a European thing. See?
Well, there you go.
Right. Thank you.
So that bitch wasn't just crazy.
Well, she worked at the hotel. She was supposed to be, you know. But I mean, I really liked the part of the movie that I really liked was how they came up with this list, and then if you have to unfortunately pause, rewind, or take some notes to really pay attention to this because they go through it so quickly, and they clearly the filmmakers didn't want you to pay this close attention to it because you couldn't in as quickly as they rattled off people's names. But they listed all the people and, like, okay, this one, she's already dead. She died of natural causes. This other one is in a mental institution. This other one is in Palermo. This other one is currently touring Australia. And then at the same time that they're doing all this, they have this guy who is Raul who eventually confesses. Even though he's basically just been badgered to death to confess. And then they move into this whole thing where I like the part where they're trying to decide between, what was it, Castellino versus Castellini, the name of the street, and they drive halfway across town, it's the wrong one, and then they drive to the other one. But did you guys notice this one part in the film where there was this weird, like, misdirection? So the Elena Markey, she's the woman who's crazy, she's in the institution. She gets a phone call, and she says she doesn't want to come to the phone, and the nurse says, I don't want, you know, she's not taking calls right now. And she hangs up the phone, and then they switch the scene over to Mario on the phone. But he says, they said that Elena Markey doesn't live here anymore. So it's like, they did this weird thing where if you weren't paying close attention, you would think that he was the one who called to talk to her at the institution. I don't know if they did that on purpose, but I thought it was pretty cool. Like,
it's a cool transition, but at the same time, it gives you a little bit of a red herring again.
Right. Well, and again, I think the idea is, you know, when you're not paying that close attention, you want to create as many suspects for the viewers as possible so that they're surprised when they get to the end, you know. So, but the other note I had was the bathtub. So she's killed in the bathtub. And this is probably another question for our European fans or friends. I've never seen a bathtub where the faucet is in the middle of the tub. Have you guys ever seen a bathtub like that? They're in every single Giallo that we've watched. They're in Deep Red. Solange had one. The Fifth Chord had one. The Hot and the Cold and the faucet and the hose for the shower is all right smack dab in the middle of the tub. And the tub is against the wall lengthwise. And then both sides of it are protruding out of the wall. And do they make bathtubs like that anymore, or is it just a European thing? Or
They're encouraging you to take baths with other people.
I guess, because like every bathtub I've seen, the ends, the head end and the foot end have walls that flank them. And then on one side is where the faucet is, and the shower is up at the top. I've never seen a bathtub like the one that they had in this film and all the other ones.
Creep knows what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I've never seen one like that, though, either, like in real life or anything like that.
I had one like that, but it was on my honeymoon.
You had one on your honeymoon?
Yeah. And I was like, I don't know why they designed it like this.
So, at an asylum, at a loony bin, they made a shower situated so she could have her gentleman callers come in and bathe with her. That's the raddest asylum I've ever heard of.
Well, no, the raddest asylum is clearly Slaughter Hotel.
Oh, it definitely
cold-blooded beasts.
Oh no.
Jason says it makes sense if you think about it. If you're laying down in it, you could actually reach the faucet.
Yeah, totally. I mean, I think it's the coolest thing ever. I'd love to have a tub like that. But we live in America, so what are you going to do?
Build one?
Yep. Got to build your own. Did you have any more notes, Chris?
I have tons of more notes, but I'm monopolizing the discussion here. So.
Okay. Eric, do you have any that you want to throw out?
I think Chris has got enough for me, at least.
Okay. Well, just a couple of quick things. It was funny. When I was watching this again, Zoe was walking around, and she wasn't watching it or anything, but she could hear it. And she walked in the room right when she didn't look, but she could hear when he first talked to the priest, and he asked the priest some question, and the priest is like, not that I recall. And she's like, he did it.
He did it, right.
He did it. She's like, am I right? The whole, like, she kept coming back and asking, and I'm like, yeah, you're fucking right. Get the fuck
Please
out,
accept
you know?
This Bible.
Yeah, that was awesome. But no, she just picked it out because of his wavery voice.
Yeah.
That, which is awesome. But I don't
know from a lot of people that it's the most telegraphed killer suspect.
It
from
is.
Any one of these movies.
He looks just like that shit drawing anyway.
Uh-huh.
He does.
You know?
Exactly.
Well, no, we never saw the drawing of him. The drawing was of Saunders.
Oh.
We never saw the guy. We never saw the guy that Mario drew a picture of.
That's his one drawing, though.
But we saw the drawing.
It's just so funny, though, because like obviously they're trying to give you the impression that because he's a fashion designer, he also knows how to draw people. And that cartoon sketch with the triangle nose, and then and then he goes walking around showing it to everybody in the. It's a ridiculous film. The plot is so stupid, and I don't know why I still like the film as much as I do, but it's like, okay, he went to three different churches looking for the American, and he got to the last one, and the guy goes, you know, oh, he looks at the sketch and he goes, oh, you should try where the vagabonds and the hippies hang out. Like, why would that sketch even make you think that the person was a hippie? He's like, I've never seen somebody like that around here. It's like a stick figure, basically. Like, who would know?
What movie was that? Was it My Dear Killer? You drew a stick figure and threw it out the window?
Yeah.
And that was how he figured it out?
Yeah, but I mean, all you needed to know was that the guy had a missing arm. And that was why the drawing made sense, because, you know, she knew... She knew that the killer had a missing arm, and so that was the clue. You didn't really need any other details. So,
yeah. Well, fun fact about this movie that I like: when he first goes to Barrett's house, and it's like all party, and there's all the naked painting on the boobies and stuff. When he first walks in, laying down on like a little sofa thing in a sort of greenish coat is Camille Keaton rolling around with some dude. And then the whole rest of the scene, she walks by behind him and she's like, some guy's like shoving her or something. So that's fun for you Camille Keaton fans out there. Just her hiding out in the background.
But I don't know who that is, so.
Are you kidding me?
No.
Who saw... No, not who saw her die. What have they, she's Solange.
Which one was she in Solange? Was she, no, like, the main...
She was Solange.
Oh, she was Solange from... Yeah. I Spit on Your Grave. Okay. She's in that one, too. That's interesting. That's kind of like that that cameo of the Birds. Was it the Birds? In Blow Up. Did you guys ever see Blow Up? With David Hemmings? There's a scene where they go to like a jazz club or a hippie party, and it's like Jimmy Page and whatever band he was in before Zeppelin. It's not the Birds. It's something else.
Yardbirds.
The Yardbirds. There you go. And he's so it's like that. That's what I liken it to. But it's a lower rent version because it's a Giallo film, and they don't, you know, they just put Camille Keaton in there instead. See, now I know her name. So.
That's what they did with Solange, Jason said. That's good. about the plumbing, it also probably a factor of conversion. With so many buildings predated indoor plumbing and all, and with so many having been designed to admit servants to help people with bathing, the easier access makes more sense. Jason is freaking smart as shit.
Yeah.
That's a good point. All those buildings were way before indoor plumbing. So there you go, Chris. You got to find a house with an outhouse and then build a bathtub for it. The other little tidbit I wanted to talk about, besides how stupid Marissa Mell is for having her twin sister go pick up her kid when someone's trying to fucking kill her, which is just fucking stupid. The whole Edgar Wallace thing. Now, I don't know if you have any notes on this, but back when we were doing What Have They Done to Solange, I had a lot of notes on that, and in doing so, I ended up getting a lot of notes on this, because both that movie and this movie are supposed to be based on Edgar Wallace's book, The Clue of the New Pin, or The Clue of the Green Pin, or something like that.
Okay.
And what's strange is that neither of those movies really have anything to do with that original story he wrote. But this movie, they really tried to promote that this was an Edgar Wallace story that they were doing. So, do you guys have any?
Where did
you want to throw in on that?
When or where did they promote it as such? Because I mean, I didn't know.
There's some posters for it that say Edgar Wallace's Seven Bloodstained Orchids.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was I believe, wasn't it financed with West Germany at the time? I think.
Is it Rialto Pictures or whatever?
Yeah, and. Even the girl that played Julia, she was a German actress. And I think, from what I read, actually from the So Sweet Deadly So Perverse book was that she was kind of forced into the production, but even so, Lindsay said that she was actually kind of a delight to work with, which usually isn't the case when they like try to get German actors and promote them in their films. But yeah, it was kind of at the tail end of the creamy types of films that were being co-financed with Germany. And so it was kind of this last-ditch effort to get them noticed and get them popularized again. And I guess this film just didn't cut it as far as, you know, getting people's butts back in the seats for these creamy films. But yeah, it was definitely based off of Edgar Wallace's book, and that's how they really hit the hammer to promote it that way.
What did Lindsay say about working with Sabato Wooden Boy?
He said that, I don't think he said too much about working with him. He did say that the film itself was kind of bastardized by the producers, which we've talked about a lot, and in other films, and that the producers really took away the plot of his film. So that's another way that we can maybe not lay blame on him. But yeah, he said kind of along the same lines of what I did, that it kind of turned into this real tepid plot. Oh yeah, he said it was pedantic. And yeah, it was just something that, unfortunately, the final product wasn't what was intended. And that includes the fact that it started as this Edgar Wallace adaptation, which had no recognizable elements once it was out in theaters.
Very nice. Chris, do you have anything to say about that besides that?
No.
Awesome. Well, Marissa Mell is gorgeous, and
she is
my second favorite lady out of this genre that we like to play in. But yeah, so having two of her in this movie was quite fun.
So what do you like better? You like her as a blonde or as a brunette?
I just like her better in Perversion Story, period. She's more fun.
She was both. She had both hair colors in that film.
Yeah, she was fun blonde. We'll say blonde right now.
I think her natural hair is brunette. I don't know. I liked her better as a dark-haired girl, but yeah. You're right though about the whole twin thing. One of the things I wanted to know is when after Mario was after Mario finds Barrett. And then he's trying to find out or figure out who Saunders is. And we know now that Saunders was the guy who got killed in the car accident that Anna, who's Marissa Mell's character, she's driving the car. He's laying there dying. She doesn't want to get caught because she's married. And she flees the scene. And as a result, Saunders' brother, the priest, decides to kill all the girls who might have been the one who was riding or driving the car, right? That's the whole motive thing. So, anyway, so Mario's at the point now where he's trying to figure out who Saunders is, and two of the other scenes that I thought were ridiculous were he goes somewhere to find out where Saunders might live because he thinks he got his paper delivered there, right? He goes to the newspaper factory, and then... Mm-hmm. So, first of all, why would you deduce that? And second of all, I guess maybe everybody just gets the paper back then. But then the second thing was, Barrett works for the newspaper, right?
Exactly.
He comes out of the end. He's like, who would that guy want? And I'm like, well, that's a coincidence. And then Mario goes to this address that he gets from the newspaper. It's totally abandoned, but the phone still works, right? Because Barrett calls him and says, or somebody calls him and says, come to this address if you want to find Saunders. And it's the graveyard, right? So
yeah. Well, the house had like a booby trap in it. So it was obviously someone didn't want someone going up the stairs. And then when he went upstairs, he found like a black coat with blood on it or something in that little drawer thing or cupboard thing. So obviously someone had been using that place, but I don't understand why he didn't tell the cops or never went back.
Right.
If that was crime scene type shit. But I don't know how Barrett had the house that he did as a fucking peon at a fucking newspaper mill.
Yeah, he spent all his money on heroin. Like, how could he afford that place, right?
And well, why he's got a good job at the newspaper factory.
Maybe he does. Why would they bury, if Saunders was American, why would they bury him in an Italian cemetery? Because I guess because he lived there, he was just from America, but like, wouldn't they send him back to America?
Ship all bodies back? I mean, is that just like a normal thing? Like, they ship bodies?
I don't know. I would guess, like, if you, like, if someone in your family went overseas and died, you'd want the body to come back, right? I mean,
yeah, but I've seen Lost, so I would never deal with that.
Yeah, well,
yeah. Okay. Yes, that was a Lost reference from the television show for all of you people out there.
Okay.
Yeah.
I need somebody. Somebody needs to answer this one. Okay. So Mario goes to talk to the guy whose wife was the one who died of natural causes. Okay. He's the one with all the dogs, and he tells him that he has a photographic memory, and that's how he gets the. He knows that. Saunders, or the guy who was the American from the hotel, was stood out in his mind because he said he went to church every day, but he was a Protestant or something like that. So Jason says they do ship bodies regularly, but it's fairly expensive.
He was a broke ass.
Eventually, Mario goes back to the American hospital to find out what happened to Saunders in the car accident, right? And he walks out, and there's the dude there, the old guy with the photographic memory. What?
For no fucking reason.
For no reason. Why is he there?
In my notes, Saunders, I just says,
why the fuck? Exclamation point.
He says Fred Saunders, and he's like, no, it's Frank Saunders. And he's like, well, if I said Fred... It's Fred. So that whole thing was just there to discredit him. So obviously, he probably, maybe, could have been Catholic. And this guy...
Why was he there in the first place?
There's no reason. But it was just that they needed to get that across, that he's an unreliable witness. But yeah, that was so fucking ridiculous.
Okay. So, I guess we can skip to the end at this point. There's a few other details that I thought were interesting. I liked what happened with... I mean, it was kind of silly, like you said, to have the twin show up to pick the kid up. And why did the killer have to go and do this whole thing with the drill and drill into her chest or something when basically everybody else was killed quickly with either a glove or a knife or whatever? But we get to the end, and I like the way that it ended. I like the way that they thought it was Barrett, and all the cops, you know, basically decide it was Barrett. But Mario is like, he's listening, and he figures out that it's Anna who was the one who was in the car accident, because he was like, you know, my wife had this nervous breakdown 2 years ago. And I've just gotten her over that. Now with the death of her her sister, this is going to be so hard to deal with. And so Mario figures out that this nervous breakdown that she had was a result of this car crash. So he goes over there and gets the sketch of the priest. And then we have that final scene where he comes and tries to get Julia. And the thing that I didn't like about it was that they ended it just kind of like, let's just throw the two of them in a pool, and we won't do any sort of combat, hand-to-hand combat filming, or any sort of chase scene, or any sort of like suspenseful anything except for who's going to come out of the pool. And the priest comes out of the pool, and then it gets pulled back down, and then Mario comes out of the pool. I thought they could have done something more. I thought they could have had maybe a little bit of underwater photography, or at the very least, I was hoping for some sort of a flashback scene where, you know, the priest, who doesn't actually have a name, he's not even credited with a name on IMDb for the film, the priest goes and finds his brother in the car crash, and his brother's sitting there dying, and while he's telling, you know, it could have been you, or it could have been one of the other ones, but I don't know, so I have to kill them all. And while he was doing that, they could have flashed back to a scene to give you that, you know...
I don't think so. Just because he tells you why he did it.
You're very bright.
I'm very bright. He tells the chick why he's killing her, or why he's trying to kill her, when he's killing her, or when he's trying to. Like, he tells his story, and it's not a very good story, but it's a story. So he gives his motive out, whatever, and I think they just shot the pool like that because that was a bitchin' pool, and they had it, so they just wanted to show it. But it's kind of like Torso-ish, like when they go out the back door of that barn or whatever, and she doesn't know who's going to pop out.
Right.
Kind of thing.
Yep, same thing. And then they walk off the scene, like arm around each other, and they walk off the scene, and then the credits roll. It's the same ending as Torso. But yeah, I could have used a little bit more of that final showdown.
Yeah.
I was looking for points, you know, for Giallo score, and that would have put it over the 90 score if they had done something with that ending. But the ending was...
What did it get?
85.
That's a pretty good showing.
And I also had to, like, stop and think. I may not be the smartest person on the planet, but I had to try and figure out how that whole phone thing worked, where the killer called Julia, and then he left his phone off the hook, which... kept the line.
Yeah. That's how they used to do it.
And so, like, in other words, nowadays, if you disconnect the call, and your line is open again. But back then, I guess, if somebody called and you didn't both disconnect at the same time, then the line was still engaged. And so the cops were saying, well, we know where he lives because... we trace the phone call. We have a trace on the phone. So then they go back to Barrett's house.
Yeah.
So the priest went to Barrett's house and hung him and then called from there, I guess?
Yeah.
How much do you think Barrett knew about what was going on? Like,
I think he knew everything.
So would you consider him an accomplice?
I don't know, because, like, honestly, I don't understand their relationship. Barrett and the priest. Was it just that Saunders was Barrett's friend, so the priest and him ended up being buddies so he could find out who killed him?
Well, Barrett was in love with Saunders, right?
Yeah.
And so, like, the whole plot was that when he found out that when Saunders found a girl and sent that postcard from the hotel that said, I found love, don't want to see you anymore, whatever. But I guess my question is Barrett an accomplice? Did he know that Frank's brother was going around and killing all these girls? Or did he not? Like, was he just a pawn being used?
Did he not know who the girl was? Did Frank never tell him who the girl was that he was leaving him for?
Yeah, maybe not.
Oh.
Because I would think that if he did, then the priest would know exactly who to kill, right?
And there wouldn't be a movie.
Well, that's true, too.
Yeah. OMG. Let's see here. There was generally a physical line trace going on, so they probably wouldn't have disconnected it literally. Ah, so they left it open. That's from Jason. That makes sense. Let's see here. Yeah, well, I just thought it was hysterical when Sabato breaks the window, and he's like, oh, everything would have been fine if I hadn't broken the window to scare him away. Like, oh, that was so fucking stupid.
Dumbass.
But anyway, but yeah, so that was Seven Bloodstained Orchids. Eric, did you like it?
Absolutely not. And sitting here listening to you guys go through the plot once again, oh my god. I'm sorry. I mean, your insight, the insight was great. I liked hearing that, but
like, he's trying to sugarcoat his answer now.
You're dragging me through it again.
I can't.
Oh, why? No, I'm trying to be positive about you guys. I don't want to make you feel bad, but
just wait till next time.
I don't have anything to say about next week's movie either. And if I talk about it as long as the actual movie is, please slap me.
I haven't watched it yet. Well, look, they can't all be winners, right? We had So Sweet, So Dead.
They can't all be Eyeball.
It's just, I don't know how you can find an hour's worth of discussion about this movie to talk about, but you guys did it somehow, so.
I maintain my position on the movie that I like it.
Oh, my God.
I like watching it. I thought it was fun. I mean, might not be as fun as Eyeball or some of the other gems that we've covered. But, I like it. I'll watch it again. That's how I judge whether I like, how much I like it was whether I'll watch it again. I think it moves fast enough. It certainly moves faster than, say, Les Ormes or something like that. But, I like it. Yeah. Out of all the ones that we watched, I was flip-flopping between Don't Torture and this one and my top number one, and if you asked me tomorrow, I might put Don't Torture at number one and this one at number two from the top 10 that we just did. So so I'm on the fence about it being the best one out of the last 10, but as of today, it was when I went through it in my head. So
let's move into our next batch of films that the viewers and listeners are going to vote for. So next week we're going to be doing The Strange Color of Your Body's Tears, and so now we got to come up with our next three. So who wants to go first?
Yeah. I do. Does that mean I can leave early?
See,
yes.
Eric wanted to do this before we covered the film so that he could leave earlier.
All right. Yeah, I'll throw mine out first. Got a couple options here, but I'll go with the one I have right at the top. And I'm going to go with Seven Deaths in a Cat's Eye.
Ooh.
That is fantastic. I'm so glad you picked that. I love that film.
Thank you.
I don't think I've seen it, so I'm excited.
Kind of like a gothic Giallo.
Yep.
So, pretty fun.
Chris, do you want to go or do you want me to go?
I'm just going to go. I'm just going to pick one. Let's go with... we haven't done a Sergio Martino in a while. And so, I'm going... Let me see what Creep's face is looking like when I say Sergio Martino, just in case he's going to pick one, too. I'm going with... I'm going with The Case of the Scorpion's Tail.
Beep, 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 beep. There you go. Awesome. And I am going to pick one that is definitely going to outshine both of your picks. It is
Eyeball
one,
Part 2.
I wish. The Second Eye.
You're not making that one?
No. But yeah, the one I'm gonna pick, it's a little weird. It's been called the Eraserhead of Giallo. So this one I'm gonna pick is called Death Laid an Egg.
Does the egg break open and like a little alien baby comes out and sings?
All sorts of stuff.
Okay.
By the way, whenever I keep doing this, it's because I'm trying to crack my neck and it's not working. So that's awesome. Death Laid an Egg. It's like the Jean-Luc Godard giallo.
It's going to be an exciting month ahead of us here and some change. So thank you all for watching. House of Laughing Windows, only version I've seen is without subs. It's not on YouTube. I don't think it is on YouTube.
Currently is not, and I don't know if that's a recommendation, but I know that we've done that one before. Not sure which episode number it was, but...
Yeah, it was in the last 10, I think.
Okay. We did, and did we ever discuss the fact that it appeared that maybe they had filmed some of it in English, or am I thinking of a different film? Because that one definitely is in Italian. I've never seen an English version of that at all. But anyway,
well, right on, everybody. So we'll add the trailer for those of you who are listening on the feed. And until next time, thank you all for joining our conversation. That was fun. And until next time, everybody, ciao, ciao.
Ciao, ciao, everyone.
Ciao, ciao.
Hey. Death of the egg.